thank you for coming to tonight's performance. Today, I'll be playing Gabriel Fauré's Impromptu for Harp. This piece means a lot to me. In 2015, I heard it for the first time on a CD from Emilio Cezanne, now the principal harpist of the LA Phil. When I first heard the powerful chords in the beginning, I instantly wanted to play this piece. I later asked my teacher, Joanne Tarowski, if I could play this piece. That year, she said no. The next year, I asked again. She said no. And finally, during the pandemic, I figured that she would say yes. She said no. I stopped asking for a while, but mid last semester, she said to me, Josh, let's try this piece out. Now I'm here. I'm thankful to my teacher for letting me play this piece, and thank you for coming, and I hope you enjoy. Thank you.
90s, Beethoven started writing for wind instruments, not because it's a good genre, but he was working for Maximilian Franz, who happened to be the Archbishop and the Elector of Cologne back in Germany. And for some reason, this guy had a very interesting brain. He thought that wind music helped with his digestion when he was eating. So what happened was he asked Beethoven to write wind music, and he asked his musicians to play wind music when he's having his meals, which is, I know it's a very complicated thought that he has over here, but yes. So this is how Beethoven really just started to write a lot of music for winds, and this is pretty much what we're gonna play today along with my colleagues, Jason, Hank, I don't know where he went, Raina, and David. So we're gonna play the Beethoven Sextet, Opus 71, arranged for quintet today. Welcome back, Hank. It's a pleasure to have you. Alright, enjoy the show, guys. And enjoy the show.
Thank you.
Tonight, we'll be performing the first and second movements of the Debussy's String Quartet. This quartet is one of those pieces where no matter how many times you listen to it, you just can't get enough of it. The first movement consists of almost every expressible emotion, from wild, exploding energy to one of the most tender musical passages in all of string quartet literature. The second movement is a playful pizzicato movement full of energy, and this work requires so much trust between the musicians, us, and which is why I think the Debussy String Quartet is one of the most significant and challenging pieces of chamber music. We would like to thank our coach, Ms. Bacher, for guiding us through this piece and getting the most out of all four of us. I hope you enjoy. Thank you.
Switzerland, and I am a junior in Coburg Music Academy. And today, I am so honored and grateful for this opportunity to perform the first movement of Beethoven's Sonata No. 10-6 in E-flat major, Opus 81A, Les Etudes. This sonata was inspired by Beethoven's farewell to his dear friend, Archduke Rudolf, as he left Vienna in 1806 due to Napoleon's invasion. And the first movement, Das Liebewohl, or the farewell, captures a complex feeling of parting someone that you dearly love. And thank you so much for joining us today with in Maya. And I hope that you enjoyed all of our performance. Thank you.
pieces I'm going to play have very similar textures and colors, and they also convey the theme of love in very contrasting settings. I hope you'll enjoy it, and thank you for coming.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming to tonight's lineup. My name is Tianjun Shen, and today I'm going to play Gershwin Heifetz's 3 Preludes for Violin and Piano with pianist Ni Xinyong. Gershwin and Heifetz were two very good friends and often played together. And the 3 Preludes were originally written for solo piano, and it was the only concert work for solo piano to be published during Gershwin's lifetime. Heifetz transcribed the 3 Preludes for violin and piano in 1942. That version showcases both instruments very well. So thank you so much. I hope you enjoy.
Thank you.
My name is Nathaniel Yu, and I will be playing the third movement of the Dvorak Cello Concerto with the great pianist, Ian Young. And to me, this entire concerto, it really just seems like this giant hero story. And I think this third movement serves as a great finale to it. So, because it has like this final conflict, but also by the end of it, the hero reaches like this great triumph, and it's just incredibly proud. But for me, the most defining part of this last movement is actually the coda section. And it's because to me, it kind of represents the death of the hero. And I think there's like this really melancholic and heartfelt feeling within it, but also by the end, he kind of accepts it. And I think also Dvorak, he'd actually written this final coda as a tribute to his sister, who had written a note to him that she was very ill. So I think this last movement just serves as a great conclusion to this incredible concerto. So thank you all for coming, and I hope you enjoy.